Well, debate continues into who knew what and what was done, and just as importantly, what was not done. What role will the U.S. consulate attack in Libya have in defining the 2012 U.S. presidential election? Joining us now with his thoughts is security expert David Harris. David joins us from Ottawa. Good afternoon, David.
Good afternoon, Brian.
Well, thanks for taking the time to speak with us once again. We're 3 days away from what could be the most defining and dividing election in recent American history. And right at the crux of that is not just American foreign nations, but the security of Americans abroad. Just in terms of the scope of American security abroad, what does Benghazi mean?
Well, Benghazi raises all kinds of issues, not least how on earth it can be that months after September 11, 2012 and the attacks in Benghazi, we're still having to autopsize what exactly that was all about. There has been the fog of war and the understandable and extended confusion that could bring. But long, long ago, one would have thought that we would have had a fairly decisive indication of the actual facts. Now, of course, information has been dribbling out. We've had highly contradictory information from the White House, from the State Department itself, and on and on, and then crowned lately by the apparent release of various documents supposedly found in the vicinity of the destroyed consulate area. It raises questions of confidence, to put it very mildly, in what the administration has been about. There are, of course, the necessary interrogatories going on these days about why various forces might or might not have been in place. To what extent was the counterterrorism security group brought into the effort, as it should have been? To what extent was the foreign expeditionary support element of the U.S. government available? But even before you get into all of that, you have the larger strategic questions with regard to Libya. Why on earth, for example, would it have been the case that a close to unarmed U.S. ambassadorial mission, as it then was, of course, in the consulate in Benghazi, was allowed to go as essentially unprotected as it was? We do have the draft reports, as they're now being described, of attempts by people at the consulate on the very day of the attack to alert the Libyan police chief, the Libyan foreign ministry, and one assumes higher echelons of the United States government. But the ultimate question is what is going on? And now there are even further questions arising that might indict the managing of this by higher authority, perhaps extending to the White House, as we find out that an ambassador, Thomas Pickering, a former U.S. ambassador, is to be in charge of a group looking into, investigating what happened in Benghazi. Well, now we learn that Mr. Pickering is alleged to have very serious connections with an organization called NIAC in the States. And a great many people describe NIAC as a front organization for the Iranian government. The situation becomes more extraordinary by the day. Then there follows revelations by the respected investigative project on terrorism in Washington, D.C., that the minority leader, the Democrat, Ms. Pelosi, had in May an extensive fundraiser featuring some of the most senior representatives of the American Muslim Brotherhood and Hamas imaginable. So the whole situation raises immense issues concerning the fundamental security of the United States, the attitudes of those managing that security, and naturally enough, the future safety of the people of the United States and the world reliant upon U.S. arms and intelligence.
David, while it may be virtually impossible to unravel this Gordian knot of a situation that's developing out of Benghazi, what is equally easy to see on the opposite end of the spectrum is this. The Obama administration has built a reputation of being hard on terrorism, supporting American interests abroad, militarily speaking. Yet, what happened in Benghazi flies in the face of that. How could one administration be doing one thing one way, but the result of Benghazi turn out the way it did?
Well, if we push ourselves back a bit, I don't really know what the Obama administration's true credentials are with respect to foreign affairs security management. Going back, you remember, well before even the Arab Spring, as contentious as the Arab Spring is, we had Lebanon, in many respects, being lost to the United States and the West through the disinclination of the president, it would appear, to have intervened in any way in developments in Lebanon, which primarily meant in the ascendancy of the Hezbollah terrorist organization and its influence within the Lebanese cabinet. So that was part one. And of course, in 2009, after the phony elections in Iran, there was the undue restraint, many people felt, shown by the White House and State Department, where there was no particular effort to support the many protesters in Iran who were objecting, of course, to the quasi-dictatorship there. And then the story of the Arab Spring and the loss of crucial allies, Mubarak in Egypt and elsewhere, followed by these kinds of stories we've heard about in Libya, which are now themselves having dire ramifications in a good number of other parts of the world, particularly in North and Mid-Africa. We've heard about Mali, where we may have a rogue state in the making, thanks to some of the arms from the Gaddafi regime that have spilled over post-revolution into that area. And again, the threats then of metastasizing quasi-Afghanistan's emerging. So if that is the picture of a foreign policy and security victory, it is a most curious one.